I have to find a certain truth. And it's kind of like if you're doing comedy, you don't play the comedy, you play it straight. I didn't have a lot of information about Anne in the script, so I provided that for myself. What's important to her? I play it for the truth of the character. I got a call from my agent, and he said, I'm sending a script over to you. They want to meet with you, and if you could read it, that'd be great. It's called RoboCop. I said, RoboCop? The script was messengered to me, and I opened it up. I thought, well, I don't really have time to do this now. I'll just look at a couple pages. So I picked it up. I read the first page, and then the second page, and then I couldn't put it down. I'd never read anything like it before. It was unique. It was funny. It was about cops. My dad was a cop, and I thought, oh, I know this territory. And it just, it spoke to me, and I really thought this is going, I mean, you could see it. I thought this is gonna be a great picture, but I thought this would never have broad appeal. It's just, it's too smart. That's what I thought. What I wasn't counting on was that the heart and soul of the piece would then carry it out into the masses that would, you know, there were so many different levels that you could relate to this movie. I first met Paul in his office, and I think John Davison was probably there. I prepared the scenes that they asked. It's kind of funny. I remember it talked about in the script about things being futuristic, and you know, you kind of got the idea that, you know, the women were going to be in jumpsuits and but kind of sexy. And I remember Anne was in the helmet, and she takes the hat off and her helmet off, and her hair cascades down. I mean, this was in the original script. I thought, all right, you know, but something in me. I don't know why. I ended up going with like a shirt and khaki pants. And I got there and a couple other gals were in these sort of sexy jumpsuits. And I don't know why, it just didn't feel real to me to do that. And I was reading with Paul. It was very exciting, you know? So he read these scenes and he said to me, you know, this one scene, I'd like you to try. I wish I could remember what it was, but he gave me some very specific direction, which I really like. And I said, you know what, let me just take a minute and I'm gonna go out and work on that and come back in. And he said, take your time. So I went out, I thought about it, I looked it through, and I came back in and I read with him. And I said, is that what you wanted? He said, that wasn't at all what I wanted, but it was good, it was interesting. And then I went off to make another movie and was waiting to hear about this, and then I heard, oh no, they're going with someone else. I said, no, that can't be. This is my part. I know this is my part. And anyway, then I kind of forgot about it, and ultimately, of course, as you know, it came back to me, and I was thrilled. You know, the energy that's in the movie really comes from the energy that Paul brings to the set. He didn't act the part. He acted all the roles of every character in whatever scene you were doing. You know, he'd run around if it was not doing this and running here and doing that, and then he'd go, but don't copy me, I can't act. That passion and energy really infused the film, because he was, I always liked to think, like a mad genius. Come out there and, you know, why are we not shooting? I mean, he was really, he'd just go crazy. Why is it taking so long? It kept moving. It was like a train. It started and just kept going and going and going. And the brilliance of, I mean, it's not exactly beautiful lighting in that film. It was totally right. These banks of fluorescent lights that could just be placed. And Yost Vacano had created his own gyro, whatever, on the camera that he could move and run and go. I mean, you could shoot it like a play. You could go. There really was so few limitations, which was great for Paul, the way he wanted the film to keep moving, and really great for the actors, too. So you were really not constrained by, you know, hit that mark and do this, and oh, no, you can't go there. And it's all part of why that movie has such tremendous energy to it. I first met Peter on the set. Yeah, no, Lewis is definitely not a romantic interest, and Paul really wanted to make that clear. He didn't want to deal with any kind of sexuality between these characters, which I think was quite right. I didn't really think as much about that at the time, but coming from the body of work and the films that I'd made, I was just so thrilled to be acting a role that wasn't about my sexuality or anything, but really stripping down and just having a really, not literally stripping down, but, you know, the makeup, the hair, you know, all of that stuff, and really just the strength of that character. I really loved it. The hair, yes, the hair. Well, it started with, can you cut your hair? And I said, sure, I'll cut my hair, no problem. I didn't really care, I just really wanted to make this movie. So I first cut it to, I think maybe a little longer than here. And they go, it's not short enough. I went, okay. So I cut it again, and I cut it again, and then I arrived in Dallas where we were shooting, and I think I probably had three more haircuts with a couple of different people. So by the time they were done, there was absolutely no style to it. It was just, and I kept saying, and everyone kept saying to me, are you okay with that? I'm totally fine. No, that's completely fine. And then at the end of the day, I remember looking and going, oh my God, I don't mind it being short, but this is really a bad haircut. So I had to get over that really fast. You know, hindsight's 20/20. I thought, you know, if I could do it again, I would have cut it really, really, really short, because I could have worn it then, and I think it would have been a kind of a cool look, a very modern look for that character. But anyway, it is what it is.
I better drive until you know your way around.
I so wish I could take credit for the bubblegum, but it was actually in the script. So I guess I have to thank Ed Neumeier and Michael Miner for that. Paul Verhoeven wanted it to pop at a very specific moment. You have to do this, and then it's go. I'm like, okay, I can chew gum, I can make bubbles, but the timing of it was a little bit of a challenge. I went through some terrific training with Steve Estrada, who trained the recruits at the police academy, and I had never held a gun before, which is interesting because my father had two guns, and he'd come home from work and the guns would come off his belt and they'd be first placed on the dresser, and then up. I mean, we knew never to touch all of that, so I thought, well, you know, I better put my hands on a gun. So I trained with him, and of course, Randy Moore, who was the munitions expert on the film, but I loved going to the police academy, and I loved shooting the targets, and it was such a great challenge, and I was pretty good at it. I did extend it probably a little more than I should have. I kept saying, yeah, I think I need to go back. I was having so much fun. It was important for me that I didn't feel like, oh, I have the gun now. That just, it was just part of me and comfortable when I was working, not to be something that was distracting from whatever I was doing in the scene. So we left Dallas for Manesson, Pennsylvania, with this fabulous steel mill. In my recollection, it was not completely abandoned, but it was cold, very grim gray skies, and but I remember getting there thinking, wow, this is perfect, this is great, you know, it's just that kind of gritty environment. But the water that I had to go into was rusty, and it was freezing cold. They encouraged me to put on a wetsuit under my jumpsuit. And I said, oh, no, I am not putting on a wetsuit. I'll look like a whale. I am not doing it. And they said, well, you know, the water, it's cold, it's really, you know, disgusting. And I said, no, I can handle it. And of course, after I did it once and came out, I said, oh, put the wetsuit on, this was really horrible. But it was certainly not comfortable shooting there. You know, it really was not comfortable. And that's okay. You know, sometimes that helps you with whatever it is that you're doing. You don't need to be comfortable and every time you're shooting something. And I think it would have been impossible to recreate. You could kind of recreate it on a soundstage, but there's something happens when you're shooting in a practical location. It really kind of, having the right costume on, it's like having the right environment really helps you with what you're doing. And at the end of the day, we had a great old time there anyhow. We managed to have a good time shooting. I I love that scene. And I get chills just thinking about it. I feel emotional even just imagining that scene where he takes off the helmet, and as it was called, the third act face, and holding that mirror up. It was, I almost didn't even have to prepare anything. All I had to do was really just look at him. I felt that it was just right, the way that that was shot and the way that it was cut. It made such a great impact on the audience. And I also, you mentioned the scene where he goes back to visit his home. Both of those scenes, I don't care how many times I see the movie, they really make me very, very emotional. Move me to tears, really. Situated near schools and shopping centers, this progressive development has a growth. And again, I think that's Paul. I mean, that's the way he shot it, and the simplicity of how it was done. And it's what was in the silence, really. It's what's not said that makes it so powerful. Peter did suffer. I mean, the discipline it takes to do what he had to do. It took 6 hours to put on the makeup for that. And he'd come in, you know, I don't know, 3 a.m. and just sit while they did that. And they paint every little detail. And I think it was Stefan who did it. And then the face really was only good for a few hours. And one day, they didn't shoot him, and they didn't shoot him, and they didn't shoot him. And of course, the face was probably melting like a meal, you know. But he was so unhappy that he'd been sitting waiting to shoot that he painted polka dots. He just put polka dots all over. You know, actors have to do something to amuse themselves when they're not shooting. And that was, and I have a picture of that somewhere. It's pretty funny. But yeah, it was tough on him. It was tough on everybody. And even Paul McCrane had to have the face for melting Emile face. And Kurtwood. I mean, so yeah, actors were really troopers on this. But they, you know, it's like when you're making a movie that you know is going to be a great movie, because you can feel it when you're on the set, you'll go to the ends of the earth for your director, because you just want to do everything you can do to contribute to the success of the film.
You a good cop, hot shot.
Yeah, you know, and I think there's also something, I believe this, about casting. If you've got a really bad guy, if he's just that, if that's the only aspect, and he's kind of like a really creepy person and not nice, You have a very flat, one-dimensional character. But, you know, Kurt was a very warm guy, and as is Paul McCrane and Ray Wise. And so if you have that, that's their soul, their character of who they are, and then you layer it in with the other aspects of the character, you can't just hate them. I mean, you couldn't just hate Kurtwood.
Hiya, Barbara. Listen, I'm here to see Dick Jones.
You laugh, you kind of like, there's something about him, and I think that's Kurtwood, not the characters. That little piece of him that comes through. Otherwise, you just want this guy annihilated, which of course you do by the end. Oh, Ed Neumeier was on the set all the time, and very essential, I think, in the shooting of the film and being right by Paul Verhoeven's side, especially with some of the funny parts, you know, because there are maybe a different sensibility, sense of humor. I think Ed could clarify some of those moments in the film. But I think too, it was just great to have the writer nearby. And, you know, honestly, from my experience, I don't know that much of anything changed in that script, because it was probably close to being a perfect script. The end changed. Now that I remember, the end changed, because there was a scene of Lewis in the hospital, and the running line of "you can't stand the heat, stay out of the kitchen," and but it was kind of a downer end, or not really, very anticlimactic, I think. So I think what's there now is amazing.
I'm a mess.
They'll fix you. They fix everything.
I didn't really think about a sequel at the time. Nobody talked about it, at least not to me. And but everybody made the assumption. They wrote about it. People said, oh, you're coming back as a cyborg. I said, I have no clue about any of that. And I don't know how I would have felt about it, to be honest with you. Certainly a lot of work, really challenging physically, just physically really challenging, especially in the beginning because those suits were just heavy and cumbersome and hard to get together. But yeah, you know, it could have been interesting to do something like that, challenging. I don't know. Whatever. Certainly prepared more physically then than I might have been a few years before. I love John Davison. First of all, he just loves movies. He loves making movies. He's just always so happy, and he's really under the radar a lot, I have to say. You know, he does so much. He actually said, I remember he actually produced Airplane. And here's one of my regrets of my career, because I remember the script coming to me and laughing out loud when I was reading it. And they said, well, you know, they really want you. They really would like to see you and talk to you about this film. And I said, two directors? I don't think so. This is never going to work. Three, that's right. Three directors. Yes. Oh, my God. I said, that's never going to work. You can't make a movie like that. But it's so funny. I know, it's so funny. I laughed out loud. And I remember John saying to me, well, finally, I got you in a movie. So, you know, it's just a nice, I mean, obviously, I think Julie Haggerty really killed it. So I don't know that I could have done better even as well.
Are you locked in now?
Yes.
A little more to the left.
Well, you know, again, I have to give everybody props. I mean, it was not an easy shoot. It really wasn't. It was brutally hot in Dallas. I would say that, again, you know, Peter's discipline, being in that suit, and they'd have to bring in a big, you know, air conditioning hose and try to get some air down into that suit so he could, you know, just not pass out. But the team, we call them the Robo team, and the guys who put him together and did the makeup, just extraordinary talent in every single department. And I would just say that energetically on the set, it was probably one of the most positive environments that I ever worked in. Every day, no matter how hard it was really a joy to be there. And even in Manassas, Pennsylvania, every department was stellar. Yeah. So I would just say it was really wonderful memories and great people, great talent, and fortunate to have been part of it.